Hello friends, welcome to Dr. Ved channel. I am Dr. P.R. Patel, Profession Head, Veterinary Medicine. We have already seen two parts of verminous bronchitis. Here we will continue with part 3. In this part 3, we will discuss diagnosis, lesions, differential diagnosis, treatment and control of verminous bronchitis in domestic animals. First, we will see diagnosis. The diagnosis is based on clinical signs. The signs of bronchitis, rapid breathing, severe respiratory distress, dyspnea, and coughing. These are characteristic clinical signs. But based on these signs, it is difficult to provide diagnosis because these signs are also observed in many bronchopneumonia cases. But these signs accompany with epidemiology of disease, that occurrence of disease in the area in particular season and the animals infected, the parasites found, this will help in confirmation of the diagnosis. Further, as a clinician, clinical examination of respiratory tract, especially lower respiratory tract, the trachea, bronchi, bronchiole, and a lung parenchyma. This helps us in the find out the portion which is affected and type of pathology. Auscultation is the main tool for examination of this respiratory tract. Fecal examination. One can demonstrate first stage larva or larvated egg in the fecal examination, and techniques for concentration of these eggs and larvae is fecal flotation technique. Better techniques for the demonstration of presence of first stage larva and feces is by Bierman technique. In next slide, what is the Bierman technique. Bierman technique is to recover the larva. The large fecal sample, approximately 25 to 30 gram, is taken. The fecal sample is to be wrapped in tissue paper or cheesecloth. This sample wrapped in tissue paper and cheesecloth is either suspended or placed in water in a beaker. Then, after 4 hours, the water at the bottom of beaker is examined for the larva. If there is heavy infection, then larva may be recovered within 30 minutes. So this Bierman technique is a specialized technique to recover the larva. Continuation of the diagnosis. On examination of sputum and nasal discharge under the microscope, clinician can find eggs. Examination of bronchial lavage and tracheal washings of dogs and horse, clinician can examine for eggs, larvae, and eosinophils. Remember here, the larvae are not found in feces, in pre-patent or post-patent feces. Because in pre-patent, larva is present, not the adult. So, they don't lay eggs. So, no eggs in feces. In post-patent feces, the adults are expelled out, so also there is no eggs in the feces. Postpatent phase is a recovery phase. Bronchoscopy help in diagnosis of various lesions present in trachea and bronchial and bronchi. Radiographic examination, one can check the pathology in the lower respiratory tract. Serological test, ELISA, is also useful for the confirmation of the diagnosis. Postmortem lesions, if you have attended properly the pathogenesis, it is easy to narrate postmortem lesions. Presence of plenty of exudate in bronchioles in reaction to the worms. And this results in collapse of lung portion, not whole lung. Certain portion of the lung is collapsed. Vermis pneumonia with consolidation of lung because of pneumonia. Enlarged lymph nodes of the lung, because the lung is diseased, so lymph nodes also draining the lungs are also enlarged. Characteristic finding of inflammatory signs in bronchi and bronchioles, and further confirmation by presence of worm in secretion or fluid of bronchi and bronchioles. That confirms the case. Differential diagnosis. There are large number of the diseases that cause the diseases of the lower respiratory tract. Large number of diseases, they produce pneumonia. Difficult to differentiate based on only clinical signs. So these diseases are differentiated with the help of examination of various excretions, say secretions, and various laboratory tests. Bacterial bronchopneumonia, pasteurolysis or HS, viral pneumonia, interstitial pneumonia, large number of ascaris larvae in the lungs, heavy infestation by migrating ascaris, tuberculosis, this all require to be differentiated with the help of proper laboratory test. Treatment, broad spectrum anthelmintic is highly effective. Benzimidazole group contain fenbendazole, oxyfenbendazole, and albendazole. Macrocyclic lactones such as ivermectin, doramectin, epinomectin, and moxidectin. Levamisole and tetramisole. These are the effective drugs, and many other effective drugs are there. Antihistamines is also helpful because parasites act as an allergen. There is proliferation of eosinophils, and so antihistamines help in reducing the relief and reducing the inflammation. Anti-inflammatory drug, NSAID, non-steroid anti-inflammatory drugs also help for relieving the pain, correction of fever, and reduction of inflammation. Antibiotics is a must to prevent secondary bacterial infection. Antibiotic injection and complete course is a must. and if any other symptoms are there, give the symptomatic treatment and to prevent and to support and to help the animal for a good life, give the supportive treatment so that there will be early recovery of the animal and there is early production from the animal. Control measures, prophylactic anthelmintic program is highly effective and it can reduce the infection to a great extent. But it must be planned by keeping the epidemiological factors in consideration, such the area of infection, the season, type of population, type of worm, all these are to be taken into account. Proper grazing management help in reduction of the larval population of the pasture. Separate grazing for horses and donkeys, separate grazing for sheep and goat, separate grazing for large animal, small animal, separate grazing for young animals and adult animals, these are essential. Animals must be removed from infected ground and animals should be placed on a dry pasture. Because on dry pasture, the larva cannot survive. Supply with clean drinking water. Continuation of the prevention and control. Important thing, avoid grazing and low-lying area during monsoon season when there is mud. When there is water, larvae survive and flourish nicely. So avoid low-lying area, water-lodging area, especially in monsoon season. Moist pasture must be avoided and allow to graze on a dry pasture. Provision of clean pasture, free from parasite. There is something called a rotational grazing. The grazing lands are to be divided into paddocks. Then the livestock are moved to portion of a pasture, it's called paddocks. And rotationally, they allow to graze on a certain paddocks, while the other paddocks portion are kept rest without grazing. For a pig, a special type of control program is required. Total indoor husbandry of pigs. Pigs must be reared intensively inside the house. Control in pigs. Indoor raising of the pigs is advisable. The infected pig should be kept on a dry ground because you know that earthworm is the intermediate host for Metastrongylus that infects pigs. So to keep this earthworm away, select dry ground or in the site with a concrete floor. Pig feces should be properly disposed in such a way that they do not spread infection. This is an important step. Proper disposal of feces of the pig. Clean and young pigs should be run on a clean field so that they should not get the infection. To kill the worms, sprinkle 3% solution of carbathion on the soil to kill the earthworms. Vaccination with young animals both sheep, cattle, and pigs, which irradiated attenuated infective larvae gives sufficient immunity to the animals. Share this information to veterinary students and veterinarians and veterinary officers. Requested to subscribe this channel so the channel can also flourish and you will get more and more information like this. Thank you very much for observing the video. With this, we are concluding Verminous Pneumonia.